Mega Praise Ministries, we're out to reach the lost, to bring the lost sheep back home, to build a relationship between God and man, for the worship, the presence, the healing, the restoring. That's what it's about. The restoring of the homes, the restoring of the families, the healing of the bodies, to enjoy a relationship with the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. We love the worship. We love the outpouring of the presence of God. This is what this ministry is all about, Mega Praise Ministries, to see what that was lost.
Fortune time.
It's in there.
It's in the future.
It says divination.
Adivinación.
Do not practice divination.
تلخی های وجود رو به شیرینی، کینه ها رو به محبت.
When the Antichrist comes on the scene, things are going to change. You don't want to be here for that. There's one way we can escape this wrath. Make sure we're right. Make sure you're right with God. And you ask me, how can I be right with God, Pastor?
Welcome. My name is Pastor Manuel Johnson from Mega Praise Ministries, and I'm so blessed to come into your homes today. So blessed. As we minister on the movements of the Lord today, we got a very powerful message for you. I want you to call your neighbors, your friends right now, and we're going to enter into a little bit of worship and the background music. But we're going to start teaching you some depths of the Word of the Living God. Now, quickly, get your sword. Get your swords right now. That is the living Word of God. And we are going to come into your homes. Oh, we're already in your homes. Let's talk about the movements of the Lord. First, I want you to open your Bibles to the book of Genesis. We're going to talk about the call of God on your life. It's broken down three ways, and I want to talk to you about that right now. The call on your life. How do you know that you've been called? How do you know that the Lord has called you? Do you even know that? Sometimes we'll step into a situation, and we think it's God, and we find out that it's not God, and we end up having a big fat mess on our hands. We want to make sure, and I want to minister to you today, that you'll understand the move of God, how He's going to call you. The Word of God will keep you, and the anointing that moves you. It is so important. The Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. We want all three as one in our life. And we know that all will work out for the good, for those that love the Lord, that are walking according to His purpose. Right now, I want you to open your books to Genesis chapter 12, verse 1. I'm going to have the reader of the word read that. It talks about the call of God that He called Abraham. He called Abraham. That's the first thing. Now, you have to understand that Abraham was actually, his family had worshipped idols according to the book of Joshua, which we're not going to get into today. But God called Abraham. We're going to read that paragraph, Genesis 12, verse 1.
Abram, leave your country, your people, and your father's household, and go to the land I will show you. I will make you into a great nation.
Yes.
And I will bless you. I will make your name great, and you will be a blessing. I will bless those who bless you, and whoever curses you, I will curse.
Thank you. Thank you for the reading of the word. Didn't you just hear that? God called Abraham. So we can't call ourselves. God has to call us. And when He calls us, He will direct us. So He had actually revealed Himself to Abram at that time. I'm not sure if Abraham even knew that there was a God. I knew they were idols back then, that's just like there are in today's society. But God called Abraham, so he knew it was God, and he actually had moved his whole family. The Bible said that the Lord told him to leave your country and your family. So he left, not just to call, but he also obeyed God. And we have to understand things. Now, I want you to go to the book of Mark, chapter 1, verse 16. Now, we just went from Genesis. Now, we're into the New Testament. That's once again Mark, verse 1, verse 16. Chapter 1, verse 16, I'm sorry. And it reads,
Mark 1, 16. As Jesus walked beside the Sea of Galilee, he saw Simon and his brother Andrew casting a net into the lake, for they were fishermen. Come, follow me, Jesus said, and I will make you fishers of men.
Continue to read.
At once they left their nets and followed him. When he had gone a little farther, he saw James, son of Zebedee,
Amen.
And his brother John in a boat, preparing their nets. Without delay, he called them, and they left their father Zebedee in the boat with the hired men and followed him.
Thank you for the reading of the word. Now we're going into a different scenario. Now Jesus is here, he's on the scene, and he's now obeying the Father, and he's actually calling discipleship. That happens a lot, discipleship. We have to understand, once again, Jesus is calling the person. First, you hear in the book of Genesis, God calls Abraham, and now in the New Testament, Jesus is also calling men. It doesn't change. And now we want to go a little bit further into the book of Acts, chapter 13, verse 2. Verse 2. Quickly go there, and as we're reading the reading of the word, that's Acts chapter 13, verse 2. The Holy Spirit calls. Read on.
Acts 13, 2. While they were worshiping the Lord and fasting, the Holy Spirit set apart for me. The Holy Spirit said, set apart for me Barnabas and Saul for the work to which I have called them.
Yes, that's right.
So after they had fasted and prayed, they placed their hands on them and sent them off.
Now stop right there, and thank you for the reading of the word. As you see the Holy Spirit now we witnessed the three Trinities, Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. All three has called. You see, so we have to understand what's going on. Sometimes we may hear directly from the Lord, from Jesus, or the Holy Spirit. And we have read from Genesis all the way to the book of Acts, where we have seen that all three of the Trinity will call you. They will confirm their calling. As you see, the Holy Spirit says, set them apart for which I have called them. So once again, man cannot call you. We're only called by the Lord, by the Holy Spirit, by Jesus Christ himself. We just cannot build ourselves up and say, well, I'm calling myself to do this, this, and this. It'll never work. When God is where God guides, he provides. The Holy Spirit needs to be behind you. Jesus needs to be behind you, and the Lord himself needs to be behind you. All three has to be ordained from the Trinity that you are called to do a work. Now, did you notice that the Holy Spirit said, I've called him to do a work. Jesus speaks to James and John and Simon and says, I will make you fishermen of men. Then when the Lord speaks to Abraham, he says, I will make you a great nation. So when we're called, it's never about you. It's always about the Lord. It's always about what he is going to do for you and what he is going to do for a great work. It's always a work when God calls you, a special work to be a blessing to many. And as you see, those that have been called, from Abraham's all the way down to the disciples, including you and me, it will always be for a great work for the Lord. Understand that. So therefore, the work that we have from the Lord is greater than the works that we have here on earth. When God calls you, believe me, man cannot fire you. Man cannot bring you down. Only God. God hires And you know what? There's no retirement when God calls you. Now we're going to read on, going to how the word keeps you. Now when God has called you, the next thing we have to realize is, what do we do now? Most people don't understand. When God calls you, he's just introducing himself to you to let you know that he is real and he has a work for you. But now the word of God must be imparted in you. We must be imparted by the word of God. So God will start bringing in his word, which will represent his what? His character, like Jesus. Jesus was what in the book of John? The living word. We have to be imparted the living word because we cannot be called by God and do whatever we please to do. It is not the will of God. We now have to shift and change things in our life and our characters according to God's character. God, how God wants us to be. And how do we do that? By reading the reading of his word, allowing the word to just manifest into you, impart into you, where the word can take it over. That's why it's called the living word. He was the living word, which means it's not something you just read. It's something that you embrace. It's something that you become a part of. You become a part of God through his word. You understand who God is, his character, his ways, his wills, through his word. His word does things to you. If we misreading his word, it's like walking around with a total void. Now you know the call of God is on your life. So now you want to understand, which would be doing prayer and reading his word. Now let's go quickly to Deuteronomy chapter 5, verse 1. As you see, Moses is presenting the word of God to Israel.
Deuteronomy 5:1.
Yes.
Moses summoned all Israel and said, "Hear, O Israel, the decrees and laws I declare in your hearing today. Learn them and be sure to follow them."
Now say that again. Learn them and be sure to what?
Follow them.
Let's say that again. Learn them and be sure to follow them. As you have learned, and we read in the New Testament, the Bible tells us, don't just be hearers of the word, be doers of the word. And that's actually Moses saying the same thing that is repeated in different wordings in the New Testament. We cannot just be hearers of the word, but we must be doers of the word. Would you read that line again?
Learn them and be sure to follow them.
Now the word of God spoken through Moses is saying to learn them, not just and be sure to follow them. So it's not something that we're just reading and then we forget about it later. The Lord wants us to learn the word of God and then practice the word of God in our lifestyle, because God is not happy with man's lifestyle right now, because we want to do everything we want to do. This is the reason why the Bible tells us in the book of Genesis that God's spirit will not always thrive with man. Why? Because man thinks evil thoughts. He wants to do evil thoughts. Evil can come into man at any time. Frustration, the impatience, this because of the flesh is taking over. We have to understand that this is not the will of God. The more of the word of God that's been imparted into us, the more we become Christ-like, because we are acting in that word, walking in that word, speaking that word, living and breathing and being blessed, because there's a result. Not just the inner man that's going to change, but because you're walking in the word of God, you are allowing things on the outside will change too. But first the inner man has to change, because the word of God is powerful and sharper than a two-edged sword. So we have to understand the call is there. Now the word of God has to be imparted in. Now let's move forward. I want you to go to Matthew chapter 4, verse 1. Matthew chapter 4, verse 1. I pray that you're enjoying this. We're going to minister more on this, and we will pray for you at the end of the program.
Matthew 4, 1. Then Jesus was led by the Spirit into the desert to be tempted by the devil.
Now why? Now stop right there. Thank you. Why do you think that has happened? Why do you think the Holy Spirit will lead you or led Jesus into the wilderness or the desert to be tempted by the devil? Why? Because now the word of God is in him. We will be tested. We may not go through whatever what Jesus had went through, but we will be tested from time to time. When he goes away, he doesn't always stay away. When the Satan leaves, he doesn't, he just leaves for a moment. He doesn't always guilt, but he will come back. But understand something, because as long as he is ruling this world, he will come back and try again. So we have to continue to bind ourselves with the word of God and speak the word of God. Now he has been called, Jesus has been called to his ministry. That was definitely evidence in the Jordan River as he got baptized, and he got baptized in water. Then the Holy Spirit came on him, and then the voice from God confirmed who he was. And he was led into the wilderness to be tempted by the desert, be tempted by the devil, I'm sorry. But he used the word of God. Each time Satan came at him, the Lord said, "It is written." So he didn't just know it, but he also practices as Moses had spoke to the congregation of Israel, which was over 2 million at that time. And I'm telling you, it has to be practiced, because once it is imparted, it has to be practiced. And the word of God will definitely never come back void if you are truly walking in it. Amen? Amen. Let's move forward. Now, read on Matthew chapter 4, verse 1. Read on to verse 2.
Matthew 4, verse 2. After fasting 40 days and 40 nights, he was hungry. The tempter came to him and said, "If you are the Son of God,
yes,
tell these stones to become bread."
Now stop right there. Did you notice what Satan did? He goes and says, "If you are the Son of God." Satan will question your calling. He didn't question whether Jesus had the word or not. He questioned his calling. If you are the Son of God, God had called him. It's like, oh, if you're a child of God, then whatever. You have to come back. Did you know Jesus did not say, I am a child of God. I am the Son of God. He did not say that. He didn't sit there and argue with Satan. God doesn't want us to argue with Satan. He doesn't want us to argue with familiar spirits. You got authority in you. All you have to do is use that authority, and the Holy Spirit will prompt you to give you what needs to be said, because he knows exactly what Satan is up to with these familiar spirits, what temptation is up to, and he knows exactly what you will need to say that thing will be backed off of you. Amen? Amen. Now, let's go quickly. That anointing now. Well, when we're talking about that anointing, quickly, why don't you go to 2 Kings. 2 Kings chapter 2, verse 6. Now, you got the call. Now, the word of God is in you. Now, you need the power of God, the anointing. The anointing is what moves you. You have the word. You got the call. Now, you need that anointing. The anointing will move you. It's at 2 Kings chapter 2, verse 6.
2 Kings 2, 6. Then Elijah said to him, "Stay here. The Lord has sent me to Jordan."
Keep going.
And he replied, "As surely as the Lord lives and as you live,
yes,
I will not leave you."
I will not leave you. Keep going.
So the two of them walked on.
Keep going.
50 men of the company of the prophets went and stood at a distance.
Yes.
Facing the place where Elijah and Elisha had stopped at the Jordan. Elijah took his cloak, rolled it up, and struck the water with it.
Keep going.
The water divided to the right and to the left.
What a powerful anointing as we're reading this. Read on.
And the two of them crossed over on dry ground.
Keep going.
When they had crossed, Elijah said to Elisha, "Tell me, what can I do for you before I am taken from you?"
Read on.
"Let me inherit a double portion of your spirit," Elisha replied.
Now, you people out there say the same thing. I need a double portion. I need a triple portion. You know exactly what you need, what God wants to give you. Why would he say that? Because, first of all, you have to understand, Elisha realized that he was going to have a bigger, powerful ministry more than his teacher. Not that he was better than Eliab. It's just that he knew that his ministry, that what God had called him, was going to be very powerful, and he needed everything he could get from the Lord through the vessel Eliab. Now Elijah says, I want a double portion. And that was enough to satisfy his whole ministry, as we read in 2 Kings. Now, many of us don't know. When God gives you, when he calls you, and when the word of God in you, you're gonna know what you're gonna need. That's what happened with Jesus. Now, the Spirit of the Lord is moving. The book of Songs tells us in chapter 51, David says, take not your Holy Spirit from me. Now, we're not gonna read that. We're gonna go on, but I'm just letting you know. Songs 51 says, take not your Spirit from me, the verse 10 through 11. David is saying that. Why? That was so important. That anointing, that the Spirit of God, which was that anointing on him, got David through some very, very, very tough times, as we know. And he also, when the anointing had came upon David, he had never felt that before. The call was upon him. The word of God was upon David. You can tell just by the way his life was. He was quoting the word of God all the time. So the anointing of God was on him too. And he realized that was so important, it could not leave him. Now, when we go to 1 Samuel chapter 16, we see when that anointing had it moves you, what it does. Quickly, let's go to 1 Samuel 16, verse 13.
Samuel 16, 13.
Yes.
So Samuel took the horn of oil and anointed him in the presence of his brothers.
Keep going.
And from that day on, the Spirit of the Lord came upon David in power.
Now, keep going.
Samuel then went to Ramah.
Keep going.
Verse 14. Now the Spirit of the Lord had departed from Saul.
Now stop right there. Did you see what happened? One came and one left. The Holy Spirit. Why? If we do not obey the Lord, like Moses had said, don't just read it, but memorize it and follow it, the Holy Spirit will leave, because it's like it has no more purpose. If the word of God is not in you anymore, the disobedient spirit is in you, being disobedient minded, guess what? Holy Spirit departs, because he's seeing that there's no need. He's not going to follow me. If we want to keep the Holy Spirit in us, as the Holy Spirit will move us into directions of ministry and for the works of the Lord, we must continue to revive ourselves with the Word of God. We got the calling, now we have the Word, and we have the Spirit. That is a powerful combination to keep the Word of God in you. There is more I'm going to read on this, but we don't have the time right now to go over more. On our next show, we will go over a lot more on the Holy Spirit, and I just can't wait to do this. But I want you to let you know something. Many of us, we're sick. Many of us, we have situations right now. We are in a tight position. I want you to know that the Lord will never set you up for failure. He will never set you up for failure. I want you to pray with me right now. I want you to touch and agree with me right now. Those that are in their living room, those that are in their bedroom, those that are watching me on this television broadcast, I want you to touch and agree with me right now. We're going to pray that, and those that are in the studio will touch and agree with me in the studio, that things are going to change in your life. But first, are you missing something? Are you running away? Is there a void going on? Before God even calls you to ministry, first he calls you as a child of God. You need him. This world is evil. This world is not the promise from God. The kingdom of God is promised. Salvation is promised. Jesus was promised. The Holy Spirit was promised. You need the Lord in your life. If you were to die today or tomorrow, where would you go? Do you believe there's a life after death? Well, believe me, it is. Don't fool yourself. But you need the Lord now. The decision of salvation has to be made now. The Bible tells us that today is the day of salvation. You can seek him while he may be found. Right now, you can find the Lord. How do you do that, you ask? By calling upon the name of the Lord, as Romans 10 tells us. Verse 10, those that will call upon the name of the Lord will be saved, that believe it, that Jesus Christ died and he rose again, and he will become your personal savior. I want you to pray with me right now. Father, in the name of Jesus, I come to you right now, a sinner. Forgive me of my sins. I need you, Lord. Come into my life. I'm all yours. I'm all yours, Lord. Come right now. Fill me with your Holy Spirit. I pray right now, those that are sick in body, in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, I come against the spirit of sickness. Rise up and be healed. Dear lady, you're watching me right now. You're watching me. Rise up and be healed right now. Stand up. God is touching you. There's a lady right now. She's wearing pink. God is touching you. Be healed, lady. That is the Lord Christ. That's the Lord Jesus healing you. Thank you. Many of you right now being touched by the Holy Spirit. Our information will be on the screen. I look forward to seeing you next time in your homes. Be blessed in the name of Jesus. Amen.